feeling in my heart that we all know somebody that's desperate for Him. I know a young man that gave his life to the Lord years and years ago with me and my husband. I saw him. He's in a bad way now. And then on the neighborhood paper, somebody posted his picture and said, "Do you know who this is?" He says his mind is filled with nanobots and everybody's out to get him. I am yours. I am yours. I know that that young man gave his life to Jesus as a teenager. He has forgotten who he belongs to. I saw they posted his mugshot. You know what I saw in that picture? Sadness and sorrow and desperation. Not anger, not revenge. He does belong to the Lord. I know that I know this. There is somebody that you know that's forgotten that they belong to the Lord. And don't pass up an opportunity to remind them that we still belong to Him, and He's waiting for us to turn back.
God in heaven, and here am I on earth. So I'll let my words be few. Jesus, I am so in love with You. And I stand in all of You. Yes, I stand. Simplest of all love songs, I want to bring to You. So I'll let my words be few. stand in all of you. Yes, I stand. Yes, I stand in all of you. And I let my words be few. And I let my words be few. And I stand in all of you. Yes, I stand in all of you. And I let my words Jesus, for sweeping over us today with your love. Thank you for coming and arresting our hearts and our lives, taking us as we are. Dear Lord, I know in my spirit that there's some here that just really feel like I don't think I've got it together yet. And the Lord says, I don't want you to get it together. I want you to want me. I'm the one that renovates and restores and renews and transforms. It's not going to work if you do it. So, Lord, for those that Lori reminded us of, for those, dear Lord, that might be in this room that know you, but yet think, I just don't have it all yet figured out. Would you put a desperation in our heart? Would you put something so deep in us that is like a fire burning passionately to transform, to renew, and to renovate what you are doing in us and through us in this hour? Thank you, Jesus. Let's respond to him. Prepare your tithes, your offerings, if you want to give alms to the poor, but also by coming to his altar. and presenting yourself again to Him. Because it's only to Him, no one else. He is the transformer. He's the renewer. He's the reformer. He's the plumb line and the cornerstone. Let's come and give our offerings and come to receive His offering to us. Amen. Told Margaret is white the uniform of the day. Some of us got the message, some of partial message. Amen. Well, God is convicting me, so I need to confess. I watch HDTV. It is. And with all the, I wanted to share that because in the midst of all of these shows, I think still probably one of my favorites is Hometown. And I'm just thrilled. They may not be thrilled, but I'm thrilled when they buy this old home and they start restoring it, and then they have to come to the owners and say, uh-oh. And they have found this termite-eaten wall or foundation or something. And they say, but we can fix it. And when we fix it, it'll be better than it was before. That's God. So, Lord, thank You that when You fix us, we actually become better than what we were before. And before is when You saw us in Your heavenly vision in Psalm 139 and said, I've got a scroll that's for them. And I've got some really good plans for them. And that's what He wants to release. And Lord, we know that that is solidified, it is sanctified, it is sealed by Your body and by Your blood. That's Your covenant with us. So Lord, again today, as we receive Your body, as we receive Your blood, let it be as that which is like renewing energy from Your throne room that enters into every cell, every part of our physical, spiritual, and soulish bodies, renewing, renovating, strengthening, releasing us into that destiny that You decreed over us and will come to fruition because You keep Your promises. So we receive Your body and Your blood, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, His holy precious blood, strengthen and preserve you in the one true faith on the life everlasting. Live in His peace. Amen. Amen. Wow. Thank y'all. Man. Again, thank the worship team. Come on. Thank them. Thank them. Thank them. Thank them. And you'll notice Kay did not hear that. Neither did Katie or Amy or Anna hear that. You know, I gave them a nice gift, and they are headed off to the U.S. Gymnastics Women's Finals. So... anyway, isn't it a good morning? I just want to follow up with what Lori was decreeing. Just for a moment, just bring that name before the Lord. Just lay it there. You may have already done it. It might be a friend. It might be a relative. Might be someone that you work with. Might be a next door neighbor. It might be somebody that you have no clue who they are, but the Lord just dropped a name in your heart. Just lift them up to the Lord, because He's a transformer. He literally does that. That's His job, okay? He does it really good. Just look at the person next to you. It says, He did a really good job on you. Amen? Come on. That's what He does. Okay, just got three announcements that I want to highlight. First off, it's not up there, and I don't want to forget about saying it. There's like two that aren't up there. I want to remind you again, the first Sunday of next month is July 4th. And so that evening, we're going to go over. It might be early, late afternoon. It might be like 5 o'clock or something like that. But we're going to go over to the Leckie home up in North Arlington, and we're going to have a cookout. They've got a pool. And we're going to do baptisms and just have fun, okay? So just mark that, July 4th. We're going to be over there. And what we usually do on that is we usually provide all the meats. We'll have either hamburgers and hot dogs or both. And just ask for you to bring all the side stuff that goes with that, okay? Potato salad, chips, beans, fruits, whatever you want to bring, okay? But we'll get more information out on that. The other thing that I want to highlight that's not up there, because I just found it out here by text about 40 minutes ago, at the end of a Lifting Up Eagles class, we always have a presbytery, a prophetic ministry, and Carrie Kirkwood is going to be coming on August 15th. He'll be preaching that morning here for us, and then we'll have presbytery that afternoon evening. And so please put that on your calendars. You don't want to miss it, okay? So that is coming up, okay? Then this Friday night, and you can see it up there on the screen, Vashti is going to be leading this again, but at 7 o'clock on Friday evening, it's a night of worship. You don't have to listen to me preach. I'm glad there was no amens on that one. Thank you. Sometimes you don't want agreement. Anyway, come Friday night. It's about 2 hours. And just come and enjoy God's presence. Bring friends. Just bring family members. It's for everybody. So if you've got people that are going to other churches and they just are worshipers or intercessors, bring them to the house. And we're just going to worship the Lord that night. Amen? Amen. Here comes the sheet. Going to have Kelly start it over on this side and make sure, again, it crosses over the Red Sea. But this is the sign-up for 2 weeks from today, not next week, but 2 weeks from today is Father's Day. And this is to sign up for items to bring to that brunch. We start worship at 10, so we'll start the brunch about 9 o'clock, and your food needs to be here prior to 9. So just sign up what you want to bring. Whatever item it is, Pat's already got some suggestions on there, but if you've got something special that you'd like to bring, please do that. But sign up and make sure everybody before they leave has an opportunity to do that. Amen? I think that's really all I need to make announcements on. Everything else is repeating as we've been watching it there. Amen? Anyone else? else need to make an announcement? Anything we need to know about that I'm forgetting? Oh. Yes, ma'am. Did you ask for permission? Okay. 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 Okay, good. Renee is her name, okay? Oh, goodness. Amen. They're hungry. Okay. Lift up your hands towards Karen here. Father God, as she goes to New York, you've already given her a first fruits. You've given a testimony, dear Lord, of the salvation. And you honored that by, dear Lord, giving her that ability to hear that last moment of peace before this man passed. But now there's the family. So, Lord, we send her out on that assignment. We do give her permission to leave. We send her out so that you will go with her and that you will minister mightily through her to this family and continue to minister through Renee, bringing healing and health and strength, but most of all, salvation in Jesus Christ. Release it now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Karen. Thank you for sharing that. Amen. Yes, hurry home. Amen. All right. Well, may the words of my mouth, meditation of our hearts, be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. You can turn to Psalm 1. That's going to be the basis of today. But it's really interesting what the Lord, the way he always does this, and how he was releasing to us this morning this whole message, this revelation, because that's what we want him to do. I hope that y'all understand that. You know, when revelations start coming during the worship and even prior to that during prayers, he says, I'm trying to set the stage. And what's interesting, I always love it when he sets the stage with the other stages that he's already set, based on what I'd already decided to bring as a word this morning, and even the songs that Tim chose for this morning. It's like, Lord, are you in charge or what? Okay. Well, on June 4th, what would that be, Thursday morning, I had a very vivid dream. And a lot of times I will have those, but when I wake up, I forget them completely. This one, and I know when I don't forget them that they really need to be released. And I've already released this to Dutch and Clay and others that are praying for the nation, because you'll see that and why here in just a moment. But I couldn't help but think, this is for this morning too, okay? And really interesting, because one of our members, just as Karen is going to New York, Lisa is in this place, okay, and you'll find out in just a moment. This morning I had a very vivid and detailed dream that I'm still trying to process everything, but I knew that it took place in Philadelphia. At one point, I was in a large building or a large structure that was going through major renovation. Then I was transported back outside, and I was taking pictures of the area. I wasn't familiar with where I was until I saw the Tower of Independence Hall several blocks away. Interestingly, as I tried to take pictures of the tower from where I was standing, it kept on going in and out of focus. And I was never able to get a good picture. You can interpret that. You know, it just, something's not right. It's not in focus. I was then transported back into the building and was looking at beautiful walls. And I'm sensing that I was actually in Independence Hall. I can't verify that, but I just sensed it. Back into the building and was looking at beautiful walls that had tapestries. And I saw a very peculiar opening or portal at the top of one of the walls that was covered with wood and a carving on top of the wood, and was not quite sure what that represented. As my host, and I don't know who the woman was, took me into another room, we were looking down on a very deep basement. The walls inside the basement were obviously being restored, and they were all stones. There was no concrete. There was nothing, and this was what was interesting in the dream, nothing that could be considered being called man-made. They were stones that were carefully placed on top of each other, and each stone was unique in its color and its shape. I knew in my spirit that something was being restored or reconstructed down to the foundational levels. Wow, come on, y'all. This is just, this, you can't make this up. As I looked up again, I saw that same opening now. I was on the other side of the room in the top of the ceiling, and I recognized it as a very strange telephone where someone could sit on a pull-down seat and then use the phone to communicate. The phone was old, but yet I'm perceived was ready to be used, and that's when the dream ended. There's something about the Lord is wanting to bring us into a time of foundational restoration. Not only for us individually, as he's been speaking to us this morning, but for our state and for our nation. This has been a common theme over the last several weeks and months that he's in that process. There was something that was coming to me, and I was thinking of giving the word then, but I said, no, I'm going to wait till I get to the message, because I wanted to get included in that dream. What was interesting about the dream was those stones and how there was nothing man-made. So I had to kind of ask in going back now in interpretation, well, what are those stones? And it was very obvious to me now that it's people, maybe tribes, maybe ethnicities. I don't know. They were living type stones. I didn't see them vibrating or alive, but they weren't man-made. Okay? So that means they were God-made. God made these stones, and they were foundational stones. The other thing that was coming to me was, I always make these statements and I'm thinking I'm going to be in heresy or something, but I don't think so. We want to say, usually, and there's truth in it, that Jesus is the foundation. It doesn't really say that. He's the cornerstone. He's the cornerstone, or the plumb line. The foundation is us. Us? Yes, the apostles and the prophets. That's the foundation stones. That's what needs to be rebuilt. Now, if you go to your personal life, that has to be rebuilt in you. The prophetic nature of having a revelation of who Jesus is and an apostolic nature of knowing the authority of who you are in him. That's foundational in your life. Don't have that foundation in place, you're going to have a really crickety looking building, because it's going to be built with things that are, it's not going to last as well as it would. It needs a foundation that God has said, I define the foundations, not you. And what's interesting is you don't look at modern construction and think of cornerstones, because all we do with cornerstones now is just this memorial thing that we do after the building is about 6 feet up. We all gather around and we puts things in the box which mean it's important to us. And a lot of people don't even do that anymore. It's just a stone with the name of the date or the name of the church or the name of the building and maybe the date that it was being, the cornerstone was being put into place. And they put that in and then they continue building up. That's not the cornerstone. The cornerstone is a foundation of stone, and it is the prime stone. It is the one that has to be laid in position first so that every other stone is in alignment with that stone. You hearing it? Okay? When you go back and look at when the Father would give prophetic words to those that were going to be building his temple or going to be building an altar, he said, don't use hewn stones. You're going to use a stone that establishes a true foundation. It hasn't been chiseled on. It hasn't been beat up. It hasn't been broken in pieces. It hasn't been made nice and plumb in all of its size. It's going to be a stone that establishes the foundation of this altar or the foundation of this altar or of this building. Okay? That is what God is doing in this hour. He's building up this foundation of stones, him being the cornerstone, the chief stone. Okay? Sometimes he's called the capstone. It's the same image. You can build up like an archway, but when you get to the top, you have to have that capstone that holds the arch in position. That is who he is. Okay? Now go to Psalm 1. Blessed is the man or woman who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. Now, this is going to feel strange because I'm going to spend a lot of time on those three lines. You think, well, why can't we get to the good news? Well, I've got to talk about the bad news before we can get to the good news, because the principle is the same. Okay? The word walks here, the Hebrew word halak, means to go along with something, to be conversant with it. To follow. There's a lot of words here. To grow with, to lead, or even to march along. Okay? The feeling there is that you're going along with whatever is out there. Okay? You're just going along. You really maybe haven't bought into it yet, but you're walking with the crowd. You're walking with what is being declared or being proposed. Whatever it may be, and let's put anything moral on the top of that yet. It might be good, it might be bad. You're just walking along. But then it comes to the key word here. They do not walk in the counsel of the ungodly. The ungodly here is the wrong, a bad person, wicked people, people that are doing consistently wrong things. And I want you to understand that this is not necessarily just this personification of evil. It's just they're not right. They're not right. Okay? We were in an antique store up there in Oklahoma yesterday, and I saw a sign that I've seen before. I should have gotten it because it really fits my life. It says, all men to the left because all women are right. It just pierces our hearts. It's just someone that's not right. They've been making wrong decisions. They're ungodly. Ungodly doesn't necessarily mean that they're going around murdering people or they're selling drugs or anything else that we would say is just personification of evil. They're just not doing what God wants them to do. They could be a family that's just desperate because they haven't linked in yet with what God's alignment is for their life. That's ungodliness. Okay? So be very careful that when people say, well, that's ungodly, that we're not trying to put this odious type of ominous feeling upon somebody that they are just the most wicked thing in all of earth. We'll get there. But they're not there yet. We're just walking along with people that haven't gotten it right. Nor stands in the path of sinners. Stand, the word is amad. And it literally means to take one stand, to have a standing attitude, to present oneself. Literally, there's another word here that I found interesting as I was looking this up in the Hebrew. It means to become a servant of. In other words, you're so willing to take a stand on this that you're going to become a servant to that. You're going to become a servant to that thought. So you know, we're going to keep on trucking here. We're going to keep on walking with something that is not right. It's not in alignment with God's purposes and God's will. I don't want you to go to wickedness yet. It's just not right. There's something wrong with the mindset. That they've bought into something that we know is not lined up correctly, but they just don't see it yet because they don't see God. And people are kind of walking with them. And after a while, you're going to see this progression or almost a regression. The progression is, oh, well, I think I agree with them. I'm going to make my stand there too. I'm going to be a part of that as well. Okay? I'm going to march along with this. And when you're marching with something, not just walking with it, you're in cadence, which means that you're not just walking along now. You're in cadence with what the Lord is wanting to do or what the enemy's wanting to do. Nor sits in the seat of the scornful. Now we're getting there. Okay? Sit is yasab. It means literally to remain somewhere, to dwell somewhere, to abide there, to inhabit that place. And again, another kind of really forceful word, it means to marry it. And to marry it in, for the purpose of making sure that you will forever and ever dwell there. Wow. We started off with just a walk. Then we took a stand. Now we're wanting to marry it. Now we're wanting to completely be embraced by this. And we started with ungodly. Then we went to the path of sinners. Those are now those that are not just not doing things right. They are literally doing things wrong. Well, the ungodly are doing things wrong too because they're not lined up with God. But now we're seeing the manifestation. They are sinning. They're missing the mark. They're doing things that we know does not line up with God. But yet, these people are willing to stand in the midst of them. Take their stand there. And then you get to the scornful. The scornful are the ones that are mocking. They're the ones that are deriding. And another interesting word here, teaching. Not good. That's coming from a teacher over there. Because we know what is happening there, okay? So I want you to see that progression or regression of things, of walking, then standing, and then sitting. I put down three phrases here that, Lord, you are not happy with those that march in cadence with those out of alignment with you, in order that you might take, that we might take a stand in the same misalignment, bringing us to the point that we will now judge others who are not lined up with us. And again, I want you not to think of this in terms of vile wickedness. It's just out of alignment. I don't know if you saw this on the news. I don't know the person's name, so I don't have to worry about, you know, just pointing out her. But it was such a vibrant example in my spirit this morning of this high school girl. I think it was at Lake Highlands. She's giving the valedictorian address, which has to be approved by the people who approve those things. And yet when she gets up, she changes the message and comes out directly and very passionately against the heartbeat bill and giving a testimony of how important it is that we continue doing what we're doing now. And she was so sweet and so passionate, beautiful girl. And I'm thinking, you've been walking in the wrong crowd. You've been making the wrong stand. And now you're judging it as correct. Lord, you know her name. You got to move on her, Lord. I pray that you'll move on her. And move on a lot of other people that just have done the same thing. I was talking with one of Kay's cousins yesterday. And it's another cousin that lives in another part of the country, and they've been up there now for a long period of time. And we were just checking up on them, how they're doing. We haven't seen them in years and all of that. And he made a statement at the very end. And you have to understand, this couple, just the dearest couple in the world. I mean, just he's just funny. She's a precious cousin of Kay's. Just an amazing couple. And adopted, I believe, an Oriental girl. I just can't remember if it was Chinese or Japanese, but adopted them and has now grown up. And at the very end, her brother, who I was talking to, said, well, they bought into it. And I'm not going to give you the rest of the conversation because I don't need to. Because we were talking about COVID and a liberal mindset and the fact that major portions of that area of the country have not reopened at all. Matter of fact, I was texting back and forth with one of my cousins in that same area, and I think they actually posted it on Facebook, and they said, this was like 4 weeks ago, okay? That's 4 weeks ago, May. We finally opened up our church. So don't think of in terms of vile wickedness. Just that we many times will walk along with something, that we then begin to take a stand on it, and then we start judging others for not taking the same stand. And I think you know my opinion on all of that is just make your decisions based on who you are in Christ. Don't let a structure make those decisions for you. Okay, I don't have to go any further. All I want to say there again, I don't want to miss the point. The point is that those that I was communicating with, this other cousin, this girl who was giving a valedictorian address, they had nothing. I don't see anything on them that looks evil or wicked. They're just walking in the wrong crowd. And they bought into it, taking their stand. And now it's gone so far as they are making a judgment regarding it. Okay? That's what I want you to hear. But now let's go on to verse 2. But the delight, his delight, the Lord's delight, is in the law of the Lord. And the man or woman who is blessed, his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law he meditates day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in its season, whose leaf also shall not wither, and whatever he does shall not prosper. Shall prosper. Thank you. Disregard the not, and whatever he does shall prosper. Thank you. Thank you. I don't have to deal with that at home now. Did you realize that you said not? Delight in the Lord. Let me make those two verses very simple. Take total pleasure in the Lord, and he will give you the revelations of his heart. When he does that, you will be lined up correctly. You won't be walking where the ungodly are. You won't be standing on something that is contrary to God's purpose for your life. And you will not be making judgments against others who are not standing where you're standing. You delight in the Lord, and he releases his revelations to you. Well, wait a minute. It says the law of God. Well, yes, it does. The law there, the word is Torah. Okay? Alan, I know, could come up and give us a really good definition of what the Torah is, but let me just go for it. Because we usually say the Torah is the law of God. Well, it is. But it's not law like a big book that needs to be followed page by page, line upon line, precept upon precept, even though it does that. It's got directives. God was telling the people what they should do or what they should not do, but it was all based on a revelation with them as his children, okay, or as our father to his children. The Torah, the word here literally means direction or instruction. It's also seen by Hebrew scholars as a body of prophetic teaching, revelatory teaching. It even gives instruction on what the Messiah is about and what that age of the Messiah is going to be about. It also, and here's where we usually set in, it is a body of legal directives. That's part of it. The major part of it is that it's about revelation. It's about teaching. It's about instructing. It's about bringing people into an understanding of what is the right way in order to be lined up with God. And when you're rightly lined up with him, you are not ungodly. Okay? Wow. Then I went to the root of it because I kind of surprised me, Alan, that Torah has a root word to it, okay? And the root word actually speaks volumes because it means to throw something, to shout something, to cast something, or to pour out something like you were pouring out water. In other words, there's this casting forth of something, this throwing of something, this pouring of water. It's full of life. That's what you need to hear. Torah, the root word, is actually a verb, which means that it's life. It's not just this law book. It's life. It's revelation. It's instruction from God. It's full of living stuff because it's full of God. And it's like pouring out water on things. It's amazing. Amazing what this word means. Isn't it interesting that the psalmist says, his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. He shall, therefore, put it therefore if you want to, therefore he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth fruit in its season. The Torah is like living water that you've been planted by so that your life will bear fruit in every season. Now, listen to that. It will bear fruit in every season. How many of you know that in the natural four seasons of the world, there are at least one season, maybe two, that you don't bear much fruit? Fall is usually the ending of a fruiting season. You're not bearing it anymore. It's now coming off. Winter. But he says here in every season. And I don't think he's talking just about the four seasons. He's talking about when you're in the valley or when you're on the mountain. When you're going through darkness or when you're going through light. When you're going through a wilderness and when you're going through a pleasant valley. In every season of your life, you will bear good fruit if you will allow my living word, my living presence, which you are to take a delight in, to flow through you like living waters. Some people hear Torah and they say, I've tried all my life to keep the law. Well, give it up. It ain't going to work. We are saved by grace through faith. And not, come on, finish it, by the works of the law. Verse 4, the ungodly are not so, but they are like the chaff which the wind drives away. Therefore the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the ways of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. Struggling a little bit with that passage because say, wait a minute, Lord, you said that we're all going to stand before you in the judgment and you're going to judge sheep and goats. You're going to judge who's righteous and who's unrighteous, and it's because of what has been done through your blood and that we are redeemed by the Lamb of God. What are you saying here? I guess guess what I'm saying is what the psalmist said, that those that have lined themselves up, walked with, taken their stand, and are now judging out of an ungodly stance, if they do not turn into righteousness by not their own works, but by the revealing of the heart of God to them, they are already judged. They don't even need to come to court. You're already condemned. People, we don't need to let that happen. We need to continue to proclaim his life and his light. Continue to release to the people around us, as we were just praying over Karen, we'll do. And many of the others you are doing with family members or co-workers, whoever they may be, whether you talk with them personally or are just praying desperately for them, that God will just capture them and release that living water of his Torah, his presence into them. Okay? Stand with me. Because what I want to do here is I want to end by reading Psalm 1 again, but I want to read it now from the Passion Translation. And what's interesting is when Brian Simmons translated this, he calls these first group of psalms the Genesis Psalms, the beginning of life, the beginning of creation, the beginning of who we are really, truly meant to be. What delight comes to the one who follows God's ways? He won't walk in step with the wicked, nor share the sinner's way, nor be found sitting in the scorner's seat. His passion is to remain true to the word of I am, meditating day and night on the true revelation of light. He will be standing firm like a flourishing tree planted by God's design, deeply rooted by the brooks of bliss, bearing fruit in every season of life. He is never dry, never fainting, ever blessed, ever prosperous. But how different are the wicked? They are like chaff blown away by the wind. The wicked will not endure the day of judgment, for God will not defend them. Nothing they do will succeed or endure for long, for they have no part with those who walk in truth. But how different it is for the righteous. The Lord embraces their paths as they move forward, while the way of the wicked leads only to doom. One last picture using the same progression for the ungodly. We walk with the Lord and his counsel. We take a stand for the truth that he has planted into our hearts and into our lives. And then he gives us authority to sit down along with him in the heavenly places and to judge righteously and judge with truth. Not judging people to condemn them, but releasing God's life and hope and counsel and goodness. We are seated with him, y'all. We are seated with him. Therefore, we declare just how he declared to us when we were broken. We now, on his behalf, decree the same to others that are broken. And God will restore. God will save. God will renovate and renew. In Jesus' name, amen. Now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his shalom. In Jesus' name, amen. Bless each other as you're leaving. Have a great day in the Lord.